Last week we looked at receiving the Holy Spirit, which is Lambana. Or having the Holy Spirit come upon you, which is Shomai. This is to have, to hold, to take away. You possess it. Alright, so Holy Spirit, directly you are born again, you are born again by the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit must come upon you, and therefore you have the Holy Spirit automatically when you are born again. If you are not born again, you do not have the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit came upon them, a Perchemai, is for a period. And we pointed out last week that in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit came upon Peter, or all the disciples, and then came upon Peter. And then in Acts chapter 4, at the beginning, the Holy Spirit came upon Peter, and at the end, it came upon Peter again. So, we can have the Holy Spirit come upon us for a period of time, but we always have the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Mm.
Yeah. Well, it's godliness, isn't it, in the sense of it, you're outside of humanity.
Yeah. Mm. All right, let's read Acts 8, 16 and 17. Please, Sheila, could you read that? So Acts 8, 16 and 17.
For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit.
Now that word received is lambano. So they believe Philip, and they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, but they hadn't received the Holy Spirit. Lambano. Now, we have already pointed out that Christians receive the Holy Spirit at the moment of salvation. If you turn to John 20:22, if Derek could read that, please.
And now behold, we go bound in spirit.
No, John 20:20.
Yes. He breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost.
Now up to then, the disciples had walked with Jesus. But here, at this moment, he said, receive ye the Holy Spirit, which is lambano. So we could understand that the disciples were born again at that time. Yeah? Because they had received the Holy Spirit to have, to hold, to take away with them. Okay. in Jerusalem till the Holy Spirit shall come upon you. And you will be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, we've read Acts 8, 16 and 17. Sheila read that. So how was it that the Samaritans, whom Philip evangelized, did not receive the Holy Spirit? Now, obviously, I've raised the point, and I know the answer. Of course I do. Otherwise, I wouldn't have raised it. But we turn to Charles Ryrie, which is what I said last week. We will look at what Charles Ryrie says, and I think he's got a handle on it. Number one, he says, it is good to remember the book of Acts is a history of how God started the church. I think we need to understand that. We can't repeat the book of Acts today because it's a history of how God started the church. It is a record of the transition between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, and much of what we see in Acts relates to that transition. The Samaritans' manner of receiving the Spirit should be taken for what it is, an accurate amount of what happened in their case. Now remember, Jesus said, wait in Jerusalem till the Holy Spirit shall come upon you. And you will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. In Acts chapter 2, that was Jerusalem. Philip went out, and a lot of people went out, and that was Judea. These were both Jewish. Okay. The Samaritans were not Jewish, and the uttermost part of the earth were not Jewish. What happened in Samaria should not be construed as normative in every case. The believing Samaritans had been baptized in water, but for God's own reasons, the Holy Spirit had not fallen on them yet. They hadn't received Lambana received the Holy Spirit. Second, Charles Murray said, we should note that the Spirit did not come upon the Samaritans until the apostles Peter and John were present. 8, 14 to 17. I'm going to read this again, Pat. I know 16 and 17 has already been run, read, but if you will receive the whole, if you will read the whole thing. 14 to 17.
Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet it was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they
and the word received, I told you, is lambano. In other words, they didn't receive the Holy Ghost until then. Charles Murray says there are some good reasons why God waited until Peter and John were present before he sent the Holy Spirit upon the Samaritans. The first thing we need to understand is that Jesus had given to Peter the keys to the kingdom. Matthew 16:19, please, Nancy. Matthew 16:19.
I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you shall loose on earth will be loosed in heaven.
Okay, so Peter was present and was the main spokesman at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, where the Spirit was given to the Jewish people. We understand that Peter was present in Samaria in Acts chapter 8 when the Spirit was given to the Samaritans. We've just read it in Acts chapter 8. And Peter was present in Cornelius' house in Acts chapter 10, when the Spirit was given to the Gentiles. Jesus used Peter to open the door to each of the people groups, the Jews, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. The second thing we should understand is the church was built on the foundations of the apostles and prophets. Ephesians 2:20, please, Doc. Ephesians 2:20. Deacon in the Jerusalem church. But he was not one of the 12 apostles. Peter and John needed to be in Samaria for the official start of the Samaritan church, just as he'd been in Jerusalem for the start of the Jewish church. Is that reasonable?
Mm. Makes sense.
The third thing we should consider is the presence of Peter and John kept the early church unified. Remember, there was a great animosity between the Jews and the Samaritans. And you asked that last week, Peter. Okay. So, John 4:9, please, Mark. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans.
This
was Jesus went against every norm going through Samaria.
Yeah.
I assure you. If the church in Samaria had begun on its own, with no connection to the Jewish church, the church in Jerusalem would never have accepted it. The Samaritans were known historically as corruptors of Judaism. Peter, John 4:20.
Verse 20.
Yeah.
Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship.
So, you understand? Okay. The Samaritans were accused of corruptors of Judaism. God made sure that Peter and John, apostles and Jews from Jerusalem, were present to witness the gift of the Spirit given to the Samaritans. God's message was that the church in Samaria was no heretical starter. The Samaritans were part of the same church that had been started in Jerusalem. And they were filled with the same Spirit. Galatians 3:28-29 says, There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So therefore, if Peter and John were present at everything, or Peter was present at least, we understood that when he prayed for the Holy Spirit, they all received the same Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that Galatians 3:28-29 is fulfilled, as Paul says. Peter and John were eyewitnesses. Their testimony was clear. What happened in Samaria was not a separate religious movement. In this way, God prevented the early church century commanded the gospel be preached in Samaria. In Acts 1:8, I've gone through it before, but you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit shall come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, all Judea, Samaria, and to the utmost parts of the earth. Philip the evangelist obeyed that command, and God blessed him. Whatever animosity existed between the Jews and the Samaritans was overcome by the unity of the Spirit. Got one thing to say. The church today should continue to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Ephesians 4:3. Please mark.
Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace.
Now, we've gone through what you need to be born again. How we should be born again. At the beginning, we started with the church today that says, put up your hand, come forward, and you're all belong to Christ. That is not so. You have to do business with the Lord Jesus yourself in your own place. And we all have done that. One of the great problems today is this idea of decisional regeneration, where you can come forward, make a decision, and that's it. In fact, we need to understand, as we shared in our time of chat, that we shall be persecuted. And the church will be persecuted from the moment anyone who shall live a godly life in my name shall suffer persecution. It's a promise. And therefore, we understand that the church should remain pure, because persecution sorts out the weak from the chaff, shall we say. We've gone through repent and believe. We've gone through baptism.